Thank you very much for the invitation to come here. It's really, it's a pleasure to be here and to talk about lazy interactions, about how we build interactive programs using lazy evaluation and some of the advantages of, and perhaps some of the pitfalls. Why am I saying back to the future? Partly it's because I'm recycling some work I did in 1985. So I'm being lazy in showing you some work that I did then. It's the year, 1985 was the year that Back to the Future came out as a film. They look back 30 years, this is looking back 38 years. And it's work that came when I was working with David Turner, who defined Miranda, which was the predecessor to Haskell. And Miranda had pulled together a lot of the key ideas in functional programming. And I think why I wanted to give this talk today is because I think a lot of the things we were thinking about then are equally relevant now. And in particular, just the way that some of the key features of Miranda, pattern matching, first-class functions, types, thinking about proof, those are the things we still think about when we talk about what is so special about functional programming. There's one extra aspect to this, and that's the fact that Miranda and indeed Haskell have this key feature of lazy evaluation. So I want to talk, first of all, about what lazy evaluation means, then talk about it in terms of a mechanism for writing interactive programs, talk about that's fun, it's cool, but also some of the limitations of that, and then through a model, which was a way that we worked to build a better way of building interactions, which may seem familiar to some of you in the way that now Haskell does interactions, and then talk a bit about, you know, what's happened over the intervening period. But anyway, that's the plan. So just to be clear, we're all on the same page here. One thing that Haskell, Miranda have is what's called lazy evaluation. So when you apply a function, you only evaluate an argument if you need it. So if I apply f to true and some other massive great expression, I'll immediately get the answer zero without evaluating that argument. So we only evaluate an argument when we need them. That's the first point. Second point is that you don't necessarily evaluate the whole of an argument when you evaluate one at all. So if you look at this function g, which is using pattern matching, what this says is that if you give me a list whose first element is x and whose second element is y, and there's some remainder called z, the answer to that function application is x plus y. So if I give a list that begins 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I'll get the answer 3. It doesn't matter that the list has 3, 4, 5. All I need to give you the answer is to know it's a list with at least two elements and what those two elements are. So first of all, you only evaluate arguments when you need them. Secondly, you only evaluate as much as you need. And the third thing to say is, if I write a function like this, so h applied to a list x's is got by applying g to x's and then applying g to x's again. If you think about that naively, oh my goodness, I've got to apply g once and then I've got to apply g again. But in that situation, once I've evaluated x's once, I don't have to do it again. So I share what I've already evaluated. So it is being lazy. Don't do something you don't need to. Only do as much as you really have to and remember what you've done. So it's the ultimate in procrastination, really. You know, don't do anything you really don't have to do. So that's what Haskell has built into it. That's what Miranda has built into it. Why? What you do with lazy evaluation? So one answer is you can have cool data structures like infinite lists. Can you still hear me? Yes, okay, good. So you can have the first list there is a definition I'm defining here, the infinite list of ones. Because what is the list? It consists of the number one stuck on the front of that same list of ones. So it goes 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. What's this? This is called NAT, which should be a hint. It starts with zero, and then the remainder of the list is got by mapping plus one to the list we start with. So what map does is apply this thing, the function that adds one, to every element of the second argument. So what this is going to do is it's going to start off with zero. Then what's the first element of this going to be? Well, it's going to be the first element of this is zero, so I add one. So the second element here is one. And you can see that you'll carry on. So the second element in here is now one, so you'll add one to it to get two, and so on. So we have an infinite list of natural numbers. So you can do nice things with it. But, you know, so what, in a sense? It's perhaps a curiosity. So again, going back to what I said before, you only evaluate as much as you need. If we apply to G to one of these things, I'm going to have to get the first element of ones, that gives me X, and then, oh, I look in here, I need the first element there, that's giving me Y, they're both one, so the answer is two. And similarly, you can write down, and it's an exercise, if you don't believe me, write it down, and you'll see that you get the answer one. But, you know, close enough. You could say that it's a bit of a curiosity, but you can write nice short programs this way. So if I want to sum the first n natural numbers, I can say, take the sum of the first n of natural numbers. And that's not a stupid program which produces the whole of the natural numbers and then all but n of them, it only generates n in the first place. So we've got this nice succinct, high-level way of writing programs. But that isn't why I'm here today. What I want to do is talk about how lazy evaluation fits in with thinking about writing interactive programs. Let's check the time. Okay, better speed up a bit. So the output of a program is a function of its input. So here's a simple way of describing a program that for every line you type in, it types the line backwards back to you. You split the input into lines, you map reverse, so every line gets reversed, and then you join the lines together again. And that's a way of describing an interactive, or describing a program that takes input and gives you output. And if I give you these inputs, hello, and ABBA and goodbye, I'll get Ole and ABBA and Begood as output. And what's more, sorry, this is in PDF, so you don't get the Padupa animation. These will be interleaved like this. Once I know hello, I can get back that answer. Once I know ABBA, I can get that. And goodbye, I can get that. So the interactive nature is going to be given by thinking about how the input and the output are related. Whoops, here. How they are related, how they're interleaved together. And the interleaving is determined by lazy evaluation. Once I know hello, I can get the first line. And just to prove this works, can we see the video now, please? So I'm just doing this sort of pre-recorded video, but now you see I'm NGHC, this is Haskell interpreter, and it's version 9 input, and I've typed in this function, it's lines, and then map reverse input, after a prompt of start typing. In a second, I'll return, so you see immediately I get start typing, I type hello, I get back ole, I type ABBA, I get back ABBA. I type goodbye, and I get back Ooh, my good. So you can see in practice me getting that to work in Haskell. Okay. So how do we get this? How can we talk about this behavior? The crucial way to think about it is that we can think about this symbol. It's called technically bottom, but think about it as saying, I don't know anything. So if I think about my particular function that's doing this, setting things up and reversing the lines, if I have no input, I can get no output. If I know that it begins with hello, a new line, and I don't know anything else, I can generate the output, ole, a new line, and no nothing else. So I determine how the interactions work by how this function works on partial data. Because one of the things you get with lazy evaluation is not just ordinary lists and infinite lists, you get these partial lists, things that end with, ooh, I don't know yet, no information. And what lazy evaluation allows you to do is get outputs from those things. So the way that we behave on partial data tells us nothing in, nothing out. Hello, new line in, ole, new line out. Hello and abba, we get ole and abba, so on. So that tells us with this amount in, we get that amount out. With that much more in, we get that much more out. So here's a way building interactive programs. You just say the function from the input to the output is a function on a lazy list. Isn't that cool? And that's what Miranda had built in. So, great. So that was there. We started playing around with it. And we discovered it's actually a bit more delicate. It's a bit more complicated than you might think, first of all. Can you see there's a difference between these two programs, where head takes the first element of a list and tail takes the rest? What's the difference between these two programs? The problem that we have, and I think that's getting close to the answer. Here, I can, without knowing anything about that, I can write the prompt. I don't have to know anything about the input, nothing at all. I can write the prompt. Here, I have to know that I've got a list with, I don't have to know anything about X and X's, but I have to know I've got a list with at least one element. The sort of skeleton of the list has got to have one element in it, at least, before I can commit to this equation. And so here I get the prompt, knowing nothing. Here, I only get the prompt after the first line of the input. That's not what I wanted. It isn't obvious, looking at those two definitions, what the difference is, because on non-partial input, they behave the same. It's only on partial inputs that they're different. And this in Haskell, you'll find there's a different behavior between those two, because this says, actually commit to that pattern match late. It's what's called an irrefutable pattern. It's a pattern that behaves as if you couldn't fail to match it. So if you do happen to apply this function to an empty list, you'll get a delayed error, but we'll get the prompt early where you won't with this. So basically, it looked like a lovely idea, but controlling it in practice involved you to understand all these details about pattern matching, which is too complicated. So what we had to do was think entirely differently about building a model of interactions in a more structured way. And this is where some of the lessons about higher order functions and types and so on in. And that's why I think this is an interesting story to tell now. So we build a model of interactions. This says an interaction looks like this. It takes some input, it takes the input and a value, and it returns what's left of the input, a value of potentially a different type, and some output. So you can picture it as something like this. It's a function that takes something of type A, returns something of type B, but it does some input-output as well. So it's a function with side effects, if you like. Function from A to B with some side effects. So you get some input, and at the end of that, this interaction, there's still loads of input left, potentially the stuff you haven't read, and you produce some output. And what I found was that you can build on top of these. So we're saying, here's this type, these objects are functions. So we're using the fact that these are first-class functions, and we build up these complex interactions by composition. And if you like, they're interactions where we have states. We start off, if you like, we start off with a state of type A and finish up with a state of B, so that what the value in the state can change, but also the type of the state can change. And so these are the types. Because it's Haskell, we're writing the types. They're very important. They guide how we do the program development. And you can build all these sorts of interactions. You can do one interaction, then another sequencing. You can do two interactions in parallel. You can choose between interactions. You can do a while. And you can pass information through an interaction. So all these things that we can do. What I'm going to concentrate on, just show you a tiny bit of code, is how we do sequencing, just to show you how this works. So sequencing takes an interaction of type A to B and an interaction of type B to C, and gives us an interaction of type A to C. And sort of this is the joy of certain kinds of programming in a typed language. Once you know the type, there's only one function you can write, almost. We apply interaction one to the input. And that gives us the rest of the input, a state ST, and some output. We take the rest of the input and the state and apply interaction two. And what this does is it appends the output from the first one to the output from the second. So I should perhaps have put that in explicitly, but hey, never mind. So we apply interaction one to the input here. The rest and the state are then applied to interaction two, and we gather up the outputs from here and the output from there implicitly. And that's how we do sequencing. So we've got a way of explaining how to do sequencing. And I've got it here. Duh, I should remember that. So as I say, what this does, it takes a piece of output and another piece, sticks that on top of the output you're getting there. So there's sequencing. Now, and what I did, this exercise, I took the code I wrote in 1986 or whatever and copied it over to Haskell. Miranda and Haskell are different, but not that different. And it would basically run in exactly the same way, except that I had to make this pattern irrefutable. But in fact, I didn't, because I had to make this pattern here irrefutable. But in fact, we don't need that pattern to be irrefutable in this case. So basically the code from the mid-80s still worked more or less. But you had to think a tiny bit about what patterns had to be irrefutable and what didn't. That's fine. But it's thinking about it once in designing this high-level sequencing combinator, rather than thinking about it every time you design something from scratch. So as I say, we've got alternatives, which I'm going to leave as an exercise. But you can define an alternative. A choice, you can define a looping construct. And it is quite nice that you can see this is defined as a nice... the result of the while is an alternative between either doing nothing or sequencing the interaction with the while itself. So you get this very nice high-level recursion describing the interaction. And you can do things like applying a function, that's map, and so on. Now, for those of you in the know, if you're into category theory, this is really the Clytie category of a monad of interaction over lazy streams. But it's certainly, I mean, to me, naively, just thinking of functions and defining them by composition came more naturally than thinking about monads of effect. You know, this was before monads were applied in this sort of area. So we can do, here's our one way of copying input, which I showed you earlier on. We can do it in this imperative style. While true, we read a line and then write it out. So you know, that's a nice imperative way of defining that. We can do it in functional style, which I think I probably prefer. We can say, what does copy do? It reads in, then it writes out, and then it just does copy again. So we're focusing on the data there. We're saying, read in, write out, repeat. Whereas there, you're thinking more of it. There's more about control there, where simply we're just using, I suppose there we've got a while loop, whereas here we've got an explicit repetition. You know, you take your choice. Looking back in the 5 minutes I've got, so all the ingredients that kind of, for me, really characterize functional programming were there in Miranda. Higher order functions as data, crucial. Lazy evaluation is very nice. It's not essential. You know, like lots of modern functional languages don't use lazy evaluation. Anything that is to do with dependent types tends not to use lazy evaluation because that screws up the Curry-Howe isomorphism. Pattern matching, again, crucial. It's a way of writing high level definitions. Algebraic data types, just being able to define data in a these ingredients have been there a long time. You could think, why has it taken so long? Well, it's partly taken so long because they're now percolating. It's taken a long time for them to percolate into other languages. It was almost all there, but Miranda lacked some features that make this style of programming easier. It didn't have an explicit lambda. You had any function abstraction you wanted to define, you had to do by naming it. There was no class mechanism, but you know, in a sense, the world was simple. There were fewer choices to make, so you had to make do with fewer features. But in a way, that makes life easier rather than harder. It's a lot easier to think about proof and tools and so on. Now, if you are acquainted with what's going on in Haskell, then you can see that the model I presented here has aspects of monad. It has some aspects of the abstraction. It has some aspects of applicative. So this model was a bit of a mix-up of a number of features that pulled out into different design patterns. Because I think at the beginning, you know, at that time, we were thinking about things from the base up. There weren't any design patterns to take off the shelf to use. I mean, I think one thing that came out very strong from this, and if you start playing around with that model, you will see it for yourselves, is that having types makes such a huge difference, because you can do type programming. You can say, I'm going to define this thing that's of type, takes an interaction from A to B, an interaction from B to C, and it builds something of type A to C. It's really going to have to do pretty much what I showed you. Knowing types and using types to drive development is really crucial. And we also thought about proof. So there was a meeting at the University of Texas, a sort of year-long, it was called the Year of Programming, and there were various sort of workshops, week-long workshops there. And I was lucky enough to be involved in one of those. And we presented, and I did some work on, and I was talking about making sure you had the right behavior from these functions. So I did quite a bit of work on actually proving that this sequence combinator behaves in the right way, thinking about how it works on partial data and so on. So people were thinking about writing proofs at that stage and still are. I think it's a shame that we're not further forward. I think a number of us thought proof would be a routine part of every or many functional programmers' job, and we're not quite there yet. Interactions moved on in the functional world. We have monads and so on, which are nice in some ways, not so nice in others. There was some very nice work by Thomas Halgen on fudgets, which were functional widgets. So he built a whole system of GUI widgets based on this idea of using lazy streams as communication between widgets. And there were real systems which were built using. It's really very, very nice. It was, you can see, and you can find it, I've put the link there in the slides, which will be available. So that is really, so this I was showing you in a sense a toy model, but it is something that was put into practice. If you want to play with this in Haskell, you can do it. The system.io.interact will take a function from strings to strings and treat it as one of these lazy interactions. So it turns one of those into something in the IO monad. And what it does is quite simple. I mean, as you might imagine, what you do, you get the contents, you get the input, and you apply F to it and put the result on the output. So it does, and it does behave in an appropriate interleaved way. And you can find all the code from this on my GitHub there. So I hope that's been illuminating. It's interesting for me sometimes to go back to stuff you did a while ago and see, is that relevant? Is it still interesting? And I think for me, I was pleased to see it was relevant and did have lessons which I think are relevant today as much as they were N years ago. Thanks very much, and any questions I'm happy to answer.
Okay, so I was just wondering, you know, you mentioned that you've done this research work on Miranda back in the 80s, right? And this was eventually like built into Haskell.
Well, Haskell was, the history is complicated. Haskell was as a response to Miranda, because Miranda at that stage wasn't open source. What happened was that the community wanted to have an open source vehicle for doing an open source language that would become a vehicle for. So if you like, Haskell was the anti-Miranda.
Oh, okay.
But in fact, now the world has gone full circle and Miranda is available as an open source project. So if you look, if you search for Miranda, you will be able to find the source code for Miranda is on the web. It's a very nice language. It's got, you know, it's small, it's fast, and it's there for use. So, yeah, you can find it. But you know, Haskell, Miranda was hugely influential on Haskell, as was ML. There was a language called Lazy ML that was around at the same time as Haskell, which was a similar lazy language. A number of languages fed in, but I think Miranda was the uncle, if you like, or the not the direct parent of, but was very responsible for the development of. I'm not sure what the genealogical analogy is, but the fact that Miranda wasn't open source was spurred on the initiative to make an open source language that was very much like Miranda.
Right, so thank you for clarifying the history of the language. My question was going to be exactly, you know, looking back, what was devised in Miranda, how it was applied in other languages, the concept of it, the lazy evaluation and so on. So I think you already answered that, yeah.
Okay, so, I mean, lazy evaluation... Lazy evaluation is great until it's not great. So, and I guess there's a hint of that in this talk, right? Because I was saying, you know, you can't always predict. You've got those two function definitions that look very similar, but they behave differently in the way that they consume. Because what lazy evaluation does is it turns a function call into a coroutine, if you like. Instead of, it's always clear in a strict language, what do you do when you call the function? The answer is that you evaluate the arguments, and then you evaluate the body of the function. What happens in a lazy language is that you start evaluating the body of the function, and then when you need to, you stop doing that and you start evaluating the arguments, pass control back to the function, and you can imagine doing that transitively. So the model of evaluation becomes a lot more complicated, that you're not simply do this, do this, do this, do this, and then do this, do a bit of this, do a bit of this, oh, that might mean a bit of this. So that model can mean, A, it can be more difficult to predict time behavior, but I think crucially, it can mean it's very difficult to predict space behavior. How much space is your program going to consume? That's tricky. In some cases, lazy evaluation is great. It means that you can, and I didn't put a slide in because I thought I wouldn't have time. In some cases, lazy evaluation is great because you never actually construct those intermediate lists. You just construct bits of them as you need them. But in other situations, you build this huge, great suspension, which may evaluate to 42. And if you just evaluated to 42, you'd save a heck of a lot of space. So you know, and predicting how much space is going to be used is really tricky. So you get space leaks. You get all sorts of stuff. There's a question here, if I'm allowed another one. Okay.
We don't have time for many questions.
Okay, I'm around though, so I can answer. Yeah, sorry, I'll try and be brief.
So why didn't they make lazy, or why didn't you make lazy evaluation part of the type system? Like, how it evaluates?
How do you mean? Well, in a sense, you can make lazy evaluation part of the type system, and that happens, well, no, it's not quite the same. But if you look at a language like Agda, you have finite lists and you have co-inductive lists, and that gives you the infinite lists. So you can split those things out. But I guess what you're exploiting here is the partial lists, which don't exist in, Well, you can do some of that co-inductive programming in something like Idris or Agda. Yeah, so that's true. Yeah, was that the question you were asking? Yeah. So the question was, if it's complicated, so can you make it explicit in the type system? And the answer is probably, but I'm not sure it's going to make things that much easier anyway. But yeah, we could talk about that. But anyway, I must stop. But thank you very much. Thanks.